Pastor was really very happy, not only about the fact that for the last 20 years this is what we've been promoting, we've been consistently promoting an alternative point of view, but also that we've come together, brought together a whole lot of eminent people here today to discuss the idea and take it forward. Thank you all so much. We will now begin the last session of the day, which would actually be, who was the one who talked about eating the rasagulla? So we're actually going to have four people who've eaten the rasagulla, who actually healed themselves of perilous ailments through alternative medicines. And it's my great pleasure actually to introduce them to you. The first is my colleague and dear friend, Jamuna Rangachari. Jamuna well, apart from what she's been doing, which is a whole lot of things, she's a person with tremendous time management. She's a writer and author. Plus, she's been associated with Life Positive since 2006. She manages the websites of Life Positive. She authored several books, Teaching Stories 1 and 2, The Magic Liquid. Yes. Oh, you've read them. Yeah, we're planning to have some more. The Magic Liquid, Elixir for Xylake, and her latest book, Dancing with Life, is an account of her healing with multiple sclerosis. Jamuna will talk more about this, but she has healed herself, or rather, let us say she's a work in progress with this ailment, which really is a very degenerative ailment. She's healed herself consistently through alternative methods, and it's a remarkable story that she'll have to share with us. The second is Benita Sharma. Benita is an independent international consultant on gender-responsive budgeting. She was diagnosed with TB in May 2011, but biopsy showed it was cancer. A believer, she put her faith in nature's cure and opted for naturopathy along with homeopathy. Doctors stipulated only 3 to 4 weeks for her to live. Since that day, she has been only on alternative treatment, not one day of hospitalization or discomfort, and she is 95% cured. So I'm a sorry substitute for Mr. Dr. Hegde, but what to do?
Can I begin? Yes. The emotions that I had when I was first diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, it was about 10 years back. I think I had multiple sclerosis even earlier, but it was diagnosed much later. To be very honest, I didn't know what it meant. Though I was reasonably well educated and all of that, I'd heard the phrase, but I didn't know what it really meant. Then of course, we all look to Google for answers. So I went to Google and did a lot of R&D on my own and this and that. And it was very, very frightening, what I read on internet. Fortunately, I had a very good allopathic doctor also. The neurologist told me that, see, if there are a lot of cases that are really, really leading a hard life, there are many people who have also managed to combat the ailment. And very wisely, he told me that all you need to do is not add stress in your life. Don't add stress. Do what you can to the best extent possible. And then... degeneration of the ailment really is that the nerve cells of the brain and the spine are degenerated. So the signals don't go from the brain to the spine and to various organs in the body. So brain is the controller, of the body. So it doesn't reach the eyes, ears, the ENT, and of course mobility. The symptoms are again very different for different people. There are some people who cannot see very well. The vision. I mean, the common symptoms are vision, bladder control, bowel control, and also mobility. Now, in my case, actually, I did experience all three. But the first symptom that I experienced, the vision issue, was even before I got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. Even the doctors did not diagnose. They just told me that take rest for some time. They gave me some tablets, whatever. I was not sure. And then it vanished. But later on, when I got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, I was asked, did you also have a problem with vision earlier? Which I did. But again, how did I cure myself of vision was actually through meditation only. I didn't call it meditation then, but actually taking a break from work and relaxing and doing a little bit of yoga, whatever little I knew, and actually praying.
You became very weak also at that time.
Not really, later. Yeah, it's a very confusing kind of ailment, because sometimes you're weak, sometimes you look weak, sometimes you're weaker than you actually look, all that kind of a thing. But the vision issue when I had, it was a real, actually it was a very shocking experience, because I didn't even go for an eye test. I accompanied my husband. He had gone for a regular eye test. And those days I was getting minor headaches in the evening and night and all. So I said, okay, I've come to the eye clinic. I think maybe it is something to do with vision. Let me also check my eyes. And actually I could not see at all from one eye. One eye was functional, totally. And one eye was just dysfunctional. I couldn't see anything. So I was shocked. Even the doctor was shocked, the ophthalmologist. He didn't know. He said, okay, I don't know. He gave me some tablets, which were actually later on, again, Google told me that it was sleeping tablets. So then I didn't take those tablets. I understood that it's obviously related to stress. No, if you are given sleeping tablets, it has to be for relaxation. So I said, okay, I just took a 1 week holiday. I was working at that time in software. So I said, I had some deadlines and all, but I said, 1 week I can't come for whatever reason. And then every day I meditated, I prayed, which is what I call meditation. It's all a form of prayer only, So I prayed, and early in the morning I looked at the sun, though I didn't actually know it helped. I mean, technically that I didn't know the term sun yoga and all, but I thought it will help if I get up in the morning and try. And then afterwards, after a week around a week, I went back. Okay, sorry. Yeah, I went for the second checkup, and I could see completely. So my first experience of healing was with meditation only. And then later on, of course, when I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, again I came to the same conclusion that if I can heal myself of vision, I can heal of other things also with something. I mean, God will show me a way. And so I explored various alternatives. And again, serendipitously, I was working for Life Positive magazine when I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And Life Positive has been a beacon of hope, a beacon of my recovery also. I mean, because of Life Positive, I can definitely say it has contributed a lot to my healing. Because apart from writing about the therapies, it made me read and write about success stories of people who have overcome ailments. See, the fact is that we are all going to have some or the other ailment. This is a physical body, some or the other issue you may have. But when you write about people who have overcome it, then you get hope that I can also overcome whatever it is. And of course, I tried some alternate therapies I could not try because my children were still in school. And I didn't want to get admitted in any hospital, whether it is allopathy, Ayurveda, or whatever it is, because I thought, let them finish their studies, not because the house can't be managed, it can be, but the point is that, children get very stressed. The atmosphere of the house changes if mommy has gone to hospital, this, that, and all. So I didn't want them to know. Of course, they knew something was wrong, but they didn't think it was a big deal. They didn't think, and both my husband and I decided that after they are well settled and all, then we will take your ailment seriously. And in the process of actually trying to make a proper routine where, nothing would make a difference to our family life, my life itself was never really very much hampered with MS. I did have issues, not that I didn't have, But I did lead a very complete normal life all through. And finally, and in that process, of course, I did explore alternate therapies also, if I could, you know, try that, whatever. And I found acupuncture. Remarkably, again through the grace of God, very, very close to my home, where I was staying. So my children didn't even know that they used to go to school. I used to go for half an hour, acupuncture, come back home, do my work, everything. It was a normal routine. And I actually, at that point, when I started acupuncture, I didn't even have too much hope and all. I just thought, okay, let me see how it works. And it actually worked. It has restored everything. I'm completely okay now. And even the allopathic tests, which I took about 2 years back, have shown a reduction in my lesions or whatever the terminology for the scarring of the cells. And after that, beyond that, I have not gone for more tests, because I don't want to. Since I'm okay, I don't really want to again keep on testing, because I think another negative thing that many people tend to do nowadays is take too many tests. And tests are, then we are not statistics, no? So we can't really analyze the tests. The doctors tell us, because we don't know enough, we take one factor here and there and then go on the internet again, and then we get more stressed and more confused. Confusion, because we are not doctors. So we don't know how the human body works. Even today, I don't know. So it's better to leave that to the doctors and do what we need to do. And so thanks to Life Positive, to a large extent, though you may not agree, Suma, you are also extremely responsible for it. Because again, even in my job, I was always encouraged, never discouraged. Like if I had to go a little early or whatever, that was not a major factor, taken as a major factor. No, but the thing is, it's a package. Like at home also, same thing with my, another big factor is my husband. He never made me feel there's anything majorly wrong. It's just like a project plan. Okay, now we'll concentrate on children. After that, we'll concentrate on you. Like that. I'm perfectly all right, sir. Thank you. No, sir, even physically, I would share that. Huh. Yeah, thank you so much.
I will certainly test, but I've seen Jamuna.
I've actually seen Jamuna at times when walking was difficult, but as Mr. Karthikeyan rightly put it, she was totally indomitable. She even used to travel by trains. She used to go wherever she needed to go. There was never a question of hanging up her hat and sitting at home. Her spirit is remarkable, and as a colleague of hers, I'm absolutely proud of Jamuna and what she's achieved.
Thank you so much.
You have added one more therapy, Life Positive therapy.
Yeah, definitely. See, again, Life Positive therapy is one thing, and focus. Focus is another very important factor. See, one has to focus on something different from the ailment. Okay, if there's an ailment, there's an ailment. Well, now that is just a part of your life. Now, if 24 hours one is going to think about the ailment, it's bound to increase. The dimensions of it is bound to increase. Like Life Positive says, whatever you focus on, it increases, right? So I never focused on MS. I did, of course. I can't say 100%, but I tried not to focus on the ailment at all.
Beautiful.
From one eye. See, one eye was perfect. So therefore, I didn't know that I had lost... Yeah, I didn't know that there was a problem. Yeah. But I just had a minor headache and all. So because my husband went for the test, I said, okay, let me also test.
Jamuna, now, anything else
there is one thing which I would like to say. I'm very, very happy to be part of this conference, because one of my prayers is that integrated medicine should come. Because everybody, the aim of all doctors is to heal. If not cure, then heal at least. So if the aim is that, then why not use all the therapies and use whatever is applicable to whichever ailment.
Wonderful, Jamuna. Very well said. Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah. Babu, now I'd like to ask you to share. You also have 10 minutes.
Okay. I'll let you know. It's about 1 minute late left. So the salient points of, your journey, healing journey.
Yes, I was. So namaste. Thank you so much, first and foremost, for having me be here. I'm really grateful to each and every one of you for allowing me to be here. Thank you, Suma. Thank you each and every one of you, and thank you Life Positive, because a major part of my journey began after I was at one of the Life Positive expos. Now, as Suma has introduced me, let me just give you a little background. I am right now living in Ludhiana. I've been there for 15 years. Major part of my education has been in Pune and Mumbai and Delhi. My husband was in the army, so we've been traveling a lot. I have been practicing Vipassana meditation for the past 30 years, and there have been highs and lows in this journey. I got married at the age of 17, did major part of my education after I got married. I have two sons who are married, they live abroad. There were things in my life which I could not understand, which had an impact on my health, which I understand now. I did not understand then. So there was a doctor who just suggested Vipassana to me. I was in Nasik, so I went to Igalpuri. I knew nothing about meditation, about anything. But I'm a person who is willing to surrender. So I took her word and I went for Vipassana. I was at this Vipassana course where when I entered, they said you need a registration before, but divine guidance, I was taken in and I sat for Vipassana. And life has never been the same ever since. I was asthmatic when I went for Vipassana. In my times, we didn't have so many of those inhalers. I was put on oxygen very often. It was monsoon, and I had a doctor who was the teacher. And she was from Pune, she's no more now, and she told me I've been very brave to come for a course in the monsoons. So to cut the whole thing short, the first 2 days was Anapan, that's a part of Vipassana, and finally when they gave, Goenkaji gave Vipassana, whenever I came to this part, there was stuff which would well up, and I kept getting these attacks of asthma. During the process, I couldn't sit through. And they were wonderful, very gentle, very kind to me, and they kept telling me to take the next one, and I kept saying I want to go home, and by the end of it, in any case, I sat through the 10 days of Vipassana. And what is so amazing is at that point I did not know. But there is a lot of stuff that came up for me. I did not know what was happening to me. I am not saying to you that I do not want any of you to think that the same thing could happen to you when you do a Vipassana course, because each one is unique and very personal to each person. But there was stuff which came up for me, big time, which I did not understand. And as it is silence, I really had nobody to tell me what was happening to me, and I had no background on meditation. But being the way I am, I carried on practicing Vipassana, and I realized that I never got an attack of asthma ever again. That was the last attack I got. But there was a lot of stuff that I saw about my life. I saw the need in my consciousness which was wanting me to get the attacks of asthma. I needed attention. It was attention seeking. It was childhood, some things which were coming up for me. Because each time I got an attack of asthma, everybody's life around me came to a standstill. And I loved it. I lapped it all up. And when I was stressed out, I would bring myself on to an attack of asthma. This is only something that I realized later, after being through the entire process. And, that was not the end. Then I carried on with life. Of course, I was not the same when I came back. I had a lot of complaints. I had a lot of blame for a lot of people. I thought my life was completely messed out. And when I went for the Vipassana course, I looked behind at everybody and said that you guys think I'm going to come back, but I'm going to disappear from the face of the earth. But actually I came back. Everybody was the same. I had altered. And that is what I saw. The power of looking within, connecting with the divinity that resides within us. You know, what Vipassana gave me was the ability to connect within myself, to be able to look at who I am, to be able to realize that there is greater power that resides within us, and how I could connect with that power to give me who I am and what I am today. That's not been the end. It'll just take another 2 minutes. Began leading seminars. I was with Landmark Education. I became the center manager for Punjab. I was leading I was a seminar leader training the trainers, and I was doing all of that, and I got an ischemic attack while leading one of the seminars. And Vipassana saw me through that again. It was surprising how, it was a nasty attack, I would say, at that point of time. I went to sleep. My husband didn't wake me up thinking I was tired because landmark education courses finished at midnight. So he just thought I was resting. When 10 o'clock, I wouldn't get up, I was awake, but I couldn't say anything to him. And he realized I wasn't well. I went to the doctor and they diagnosed whatever. But the practice of meditation saw me through this completely within a week's time. I'm sharing this with you because I know, I'm talking from experience, what meditation can do, really.
Did you do this how many years back?
Vipassana I did 30 years back, and that's the time I let go of asthma. Ischemic attack was about 10 years back. So, yes, definitely.
How long?
1 hour in the morning and in the evening, and also I've been very lucky to have had a personal counseling with Goenkaji. I've been very, very fortunate. And what Monji was saying the other day, that when you meet an enlightened master, you really don't know and it blanks out. Well, that's exactly what happened to me when I had a personal meeting with him. I really don't remember half the things that he said to me. I only remember him saying Beti to me. I went to him with issues because I really don't know. And I was walking here and I was guided to lie down and I felt that the bed was down and I was here. I don't know what it's called. Now I know what it's called. Then I didn't know what it is. But I have been through that experience.
I'm sorry, I didn't get you earlier. Who suggested you should do Vipassana?
There was a doctor, an army doctor, who suggested the first time, and I just listened because I was asthmatic. So, so they suggested it to me, and I willingly went. But for me, I went because I wanted a break in my life for 10 days. To tell you frankly. And I want to get back to what it is. I mean, that was not the end of the challenges in my life after the asking.
Thank you very much, Lokia, deep meditator.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And then as I went along, and I was diagnosed for abnormal cells of the breast, and I was going through low-grade fever and things like that. Nothing much, but my life was going on just the way it was perfectly fine. I consulted a lot of doctors in Ludhiana, and my son was in Singapore, so my husband and myself, we went to Singapore. I went through tests and they asked me to undergo surgery. So they were both sides, which is very rare, they say. So it was both sides, and then they said I need to undergo surgery, and I said okay, if it is surgery. There was something which went up when they said surgery, because in Vipassana, Goenkaji tells us, if you cut yourself up, there's a circuit, and I said, what are they going to do to me? So they said they would do one side, and after 3 months or 6 months, they would do the other side. I said, why you do both? They said, no, it's very painful because we've got to drain stuff out, so it would have to be one at a time. That meant I would be in bed for almost 1 year. And here I had walked into the hospital absolutely fine with just a little fever. So I said, for 1 year, that means I'm going to be laid up in bed from tomorrow onwards, probably. And they said, yes. So I said, then, if I don't do the surgery, they said, we cannot guarantee anything. Well, for me, that was again the turning point, because I said, you cannot guarantee anything even after 1 year. So why do I need to go through this process tomorrow or the day after? If I could have gone past an ischemic attack, if I have gone past asthma, well, I'll try other things out as well. And very much against my family's wishes, but they supported me in everything. I tried on alternate medicine. The first thing that I also tried on was, I knew that I had a lot of forgiveness to do. There was a lot of resentment within me, and here I would like to say that disease is not hereditary. Our beliefs are hereditary. We do carry the belief systems, the belief patterns. Our thinking habitual patterns is what gives us who we are today. And I needed to break those patterns. There was a belief. There was a lot of resentment inside of me, which had resided And I knew I needed to let go, but I really didn't know where it was coming from. I got in touch with the Heal Your Life, and I did the Heal Your Life workshop. I went abroad. I trained. I did a forgiveness workshop, a complete retreat for 10 days. I was puking every day through the forgiveness workshop. Every day in the workshop for 10 days, I was throwing up because I could not digest the stuff that I had stored inside of me. But I promise you, that was my healing. And then I went and trained to become a Heal Your Life teacher. I went and expressed my gratitude to Louise Hay. I have met her. Her book is like the Bible for me today. And I lead those workshops. Yeah, I've got two more minutes. Thank you. Heal Your Life, I'll show it to you. Her first, by Louise L. Hay, Hay House. And her first book is a little blue book, which costs 150 rupees. But it is a wonderful book to have, because which teaches us that our thinking patterns...
There's a movie also.
And we say that it's only a thought, and a thought can be changed. So it's a thought which gives us a feeling. Like, well, I'm sitting here, or you meet somebody. You see somebody, there's a thought, and then there's a feeling, and then there's a sensation. And then there's this emotion, either it's of love or whatever comes up for us. And then that emotion gives us our behavior. And our behaviors give us our attitudes. Now I'm a life coach and I'm a corporate coach as well. And I do a lot of one-to-one work. I love this work. I call myself a teacher of love. And I wish we could give this to all schools and institutions so that we could prevent and use these tools and actually make way in our lives. And definitely I have taken Ayurvedic medicine. I have used homeopathic. I really don't know what has worked for me, if you ask me. But I'm sure my meditation, the forgiveness, has worked for me. Because forgiveness and love walk hand in hand. And when we forgive, we drop off a lot of burdens. It's the greatest gift that we can give to ourselves, and that is what I've given. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So, Babu, would you say you're fully healed now?
Yes, I'm completely healed.
Beautiful. Wonderful.
Thank you so much. No surgery, no chemotherapy, nothing at all. None at all. Thank you.
So now we'll come to Benita. Benita, I think this... Yeah. You also have 10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay. In 2011, everybody kept telling me, you've lost weight, you're not looking well. But I was feeling absolutely fine. But I got so fed up, I said, let me go for a full executive checkup. I went for a checkup and they found a tumor. So Bhaktisiddharam Bharatiya Hospital told me it was TB. And don't go for biopsy because it's very invasive. But by the end of 1 week of TB medicine, I couldn't even have one boiled egg. I couldn't get out of bed. Luckily, my daughter, who's now in London, had come to, was transferred to Bombay for a couple of years at the right time. So I flew down to her. And my son-in-law said, you have to go to a TB specialist. So I went. And he said, I want a biopsy because certain strains of TB are resistant to certain strains of antibiotics. So I went for a biopsy. We discovered it was cancer. So my daughter didn't tell me first. She went to many doctors, especially Dr. Advani. And he said, it's of the blood vessels. He said that it's very rare and chemo and radiation does not work on it. But I want to see the patient. So next day I went to see him. He said, we'll start you on chemo and radiation. I said, but yesterday this is what you said. So I was very uncomfortable. Then she went to other doctors. One doctor said 10 days unless she has surgery. Then there was a doctor who had cured me of spondylitis 30 years ago with acupuncture and acupressure. So I rang him up. He is in Kerala. I said, what do I do? He says, come with your reports. So I went and he gave me a treatment called the Rife treatment, where you send vibrations through a machine. You have to hold two rods in your hand which are covered with wet towel, and with the machine he sends vibrations. Those vibrations are at the frequency of the cancer cells, so only the cancer cells die, the other cells remain the same. Now what happened, my spleen got okay. By the time cancer was all over me, my lymph nodes, my parotid gland, you name it, I mean. And the doctor kept telling me, and my daughter had come with me, and we were having a great time. You know, we'd hire a car, and after my treatment, we'd go loafing. He says, don't you understand how serious you are? I said, if I'm having a good time, what's your problem? You know. Then my daughter, don't do this, don't do that, you'll get tired. So I said, look, you never let me forget that I'm unwell. If you said once more, I'm going back. You know, so I got it quiet. Then after about 8 weeks of treatment, my spleen got all right. And then he said, look, there's nothing more I can do for you. He used to give me 6 glasses of carrot juice with amla, with mosambi, and a little bit of beetroot. And vegetarian diet, and 1 hour in the sun, a lot of walking. So my energy was back, but my cancer had become worse. Metabolism inside the tumor was worse, and even my lymph nodes more increased. So then I came to Bombay, and my cousin heard about my cancer, and before I knew what had happened, his sister-in-law is head of gynae in Naya Hospital. They fixed up surgery for me and everything. So I rang up my doctor in Kerala. I said, what do I do? He says, you ask the surgeon, how is he going to operate? It's in a very odd place. He says, we'll have to cut your rib and pull it out. But because it's in such an odd place, first you cut half, then the other half. So I said, if some of it escapes, what are you going to do? He says, we'll do chemo and radiation. I said, but that doesn't work. He says, you know what we'll do? We'll cut 1 centimeter around it. But the cancer, the tumor was pressing against my jugular vein. So there was no 1 centimeter. So I rang up my brother who's in Delhi. I said, what do? He said, just come. So I came here and he introduced me to Dr. Bhatnagar, who lives in Krishnanagar. He's a homeopath. So I went to see him with my cousin, and he made us sit in his clinic for 3 hours while one patient after another kept going. And it was amazing how many cases of cancer he had cured. So I in any case was not going to do any other treatment. I've always been very fond of alternative treatment. So ever since then, I've been on his treatment. I'm 98% okay. I've just got a little bit left. I've only had homeopathic. He also gives Ayurvedic powders, 2 Ayurvedic powders. That is it. I have traveled while with cancer, 12 countries. I've been giving trainings, working. Not one day of hospitalization. Not one day of being in bed. And it's all thanks to alternative medicine. But I must say also that I had a lot of emotional support. My cousin became a member of a support group of people with my kind of cancer. She did a lot of research. You know, just the love of people who care. I think that was it. I'm healthier than my brothers who had no problems. So that is it.
Wonderful to hear all your stories. I think it just testifies what we at Life Positive totally believe, that there is nothing called incurable. Someone very rightly said that when you call something incurable, it just means curable from within. There cannot be anything incurable, since we are not actually matter, we are actually energy. And once we realize we are energy, I think there is no way, you know, with the right effort and with the right work and with the grace of God, which really always accompanies every ailment, I think there's a very good chance for any of us to heal from whatever we are meant to heal from. There may be some times when we are not meant to heal, as someone rightly said, we are not immortal. Yeah, I too, in my own various ways, have healed from various ailments. I was actually diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis, and by the grace of God, it just hasn't touched me. On various occasions, I've been diagnosed with asthma and IBS and all that, and absolutely thanks to alternative methods, I've made my way through them. I've never used allopathy for, I think, the last at least 15 years. I've not touched allopathy. Hopefully, I shouldn't also. But I've also understood one thing, that never say never. There are times when you will need allopathy, and I'm not going to close my mind to it. Yeah. I remember when I had typhoid, I had to take allopathy. But I am also of the understanding that when you're faced with a chronic ailment, you're better off with alternatives. So we'll now throw this floor open to questions from the audience, if there's anything anybody would like to ask. I request you to stay with questions as far as possible. If one or two of you want to share some stories, we won't say no. But we only have about 10 minutes, so let's make those 10 minutes count.
The name of the doctor you said is
Dr. Pankaj Bhatnagar. He's in Krishnanagar. He doesn't give appointments. So you have to go there, you have to register, wait for your turn. Sometimes you have to wait for 4 hours. You know?
How old is the doctor?
He must be about 56, 57. His son is as brilliant. They both bring amazingly well. You know, he has cured, I'll just give you some more examples. He's cured major thalassemia. He's cured, there was a little girl who came with, she was retarded. And after 2 years of treatment, she is normal. She's going to a normal school. So, you know what I'm saying is this man has got some healing power.
Homeopathy itself.
Yeah, I mean, he himself says that it's not me, it's the divine. So he's got that, I don't know how to explain it. He's very humble, like what Dr. Hebke also kept saying. You have to have humility.
Yeah.
And if he can't cure, if he says he can't help you, he doesn't even charge you. He only charges you once he gives you medicine. And it is so reasonable that it is laughable. Mm. You know, and for poor patients, he treats them free.
How much time did he spend with you?
He just looked at my reports and he said, because you've not done chemo radiation, your chances are very, very good.
Yeah.
So they're four.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So he said, so now I've been having this medicine for 4 years, and once I'm 100%, like he says, you know what the other doctors don't tell you is, like, my tumor size is still the same, right? Mm. But the metabolism inside, the SUV it's called, has reduced. From 11, it has come down to less than 3. So he says once it comes down to 1.2, it's no longer considered cancer, it's considered infection. And then automatically the tumor will disintegrate. So there's nothing else you have to do about it.
You see, the thing is that in homeopathy, the fundamental principle is to really understand your body, you, personality, this and the other. So a typical homeopathic consultation for the first time takes 4 to 5 hours.
He doesn't do that.
Yeah, so that means he's gifted.
He's gifted.
Not a doctor.
No, he is gifted, and not only.
You understand that.
Yeah, yeah. Because he doesn't even want to know what you've, except that you've done chemo radiation. If you've done chemo radiation, you have to wait for 90 days before he gives you medicine. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Yeah, yeah. And then, like, sometimes if you're very sick and you need to have antibiotics, he's okay, have it. And sometimes he tells you, go and have surgery and then come to me without chemo radiation. You know, so he's a very open. This thing.
No, he's a healer.
Yeah.
God sent.
God sent, really.
He's not
a homeopath. I pay less than 10,000 for 3 months medicine. You know? And now there are people.
Compare that with allopathic cost of allopathy.
One test is probably more.
And also, when you know, he wants PET scans and all done to see your progress. Like, he sends you to certain hospitals where the fees are much lower. So I asked a radiologist, I said, how come you're charging me so little? He says, the commission the doctors get, he doesn't want. He says, give it to my patients. You know?
Wonderful. Any other questions?
Yes.
I would just like to highlight one case. I'm a homeopathic physician and I'm practicing for the last 7 years. I'm very young in my practice. But there is a case I would like to coincide with Ma'am Babu Gill. The part she has told that resentment is the cause of many illnesses.
Yeah.
I would like to go. This was my first patient, and I was also doing head trial and everything. A lady came to me with lichen planus. Lichen planus is oral cancerous ulceration of the mouth, internal mucosa. And she was suffering from around 2 years. And the best allopathic treatment that is possible is go for a dental scaling. You have to scratch those ulcers every week, and it is a very painful procedure. That dentist was my senior and my friend. He says, "Mere se kuch nahi ho sakta. Can you do something?" I said, "Okay, let me see the case." Now, homeopathy, why it is a holistic system of medicine, we take 2 to 3 hours in the first consultation. That is absolutely right, to understand the patient's physical, mental, and the genetic makeup. Now, that lady had issues with the family of in-laws. And she was under a constant resentment for last 2 years. And the lichen planus developed only after marriage. There is a medicine in homeopathy, there are a lot of medicines, but the medicine most suited to her, I gave it, and the treatment lasted for 1.5 years. And now she is completely free of those oral cancers. So my request to everyone, if anything happens in life, don't be resentful, just forgive. You will be free from many of the diseases.
Well, that's probably easier said than done. But the other alternative is to work on forgiveness and maybe go for some forgiveness workshops, do some forgiveness practices.
I'd like to add, these kind of workshops people do who are slightly enlightened, educated, and who have the passion to do. When we are talking about the masses, that lady cannot do this. Usko is particular system of medicine pe lana hi pada. We are talking about the masses. Everyone feels resentment. So here is the difference. Come, we have to enter drug therapies. We cannot only sustain on drugless therapies. As Dr. Salila was saying, ki pani se, air se sab kuch kar lenge. Now we all are living in Delhi. We don't have a pure water. We don't have a pure food. How would we expect the cure what she is achieving in her hometown? The problem is one of my patients is a Delhi Jal Board officer. He says water that MCD is supplying is being recycled 15 times. Now you can just understand how it is recycled 15 times and what sources it is coming. So here we have to enter the drug therapies, be it Ayurveda and be it homeopathy.
Excellent. Okay, any other questions?
Thank you.
Yeah.
You want to talk to?
Thank you so much.
She's asking.
Yeah, hi. I wanted to ask that cancer, they say, is basically related, yes, of course, due to stress, a lot of stress in the body, as emotional stress and the physical stress, also due to keeping the body very acidic through nutrition.
Yes,
so, did you go through the changes of keeping it alkaline through vegetables and fruits?
Yeah, you know, he gives a list of do's and don'ts. So, for example, no aerated drinks, no alcohol, no non-veg, not even eggs, because the cancer cells have a strong protein covering over it. So, if you have animal
products,
the protein becomes stronger, you can't break it down. It's difficult to cure then.
So have you changed to
I've changed my lifestyle, yes.
Keeping it more alkaline?
So I don't have non-veg at all now. And then juices, the homeopath said juices of vegetables and fruits in the season, right? And you have to have no non-iodized salt.
Yes.
Then 1 hour in the sun. And that shouldn't be positive. And actually a lot of, I also did a lot of research because a lot of people keep calling me. And this... one oncologist was asked, what is the percentage of attitude in curing cancer? One oncologist said it's 100%. And another one said it's 99%. So I think attitude is also
really
very, very important.
Yeah. One thing, just off the beat, I just really want to ask. There was no fear factor, I mean, when you started with the alternative healing. So there was no fear factor.
You know, I was... passionate pranic healer. You know, I was obsessed with it. When my husband passed away, I mean, the only thing that got me peace was pranic healing. So for me, it was like a passion. And so I think for me, it was always alternative. Nothing
helped me. Your belief really worked into it.
Sorry?
Your belief worked into it.
Your belief. And I knew somehow that I was going to be okay. It never bothered me, you know. Like I told my daughter, I said, just because I have cancer, you don't, it doesn't mean you're going to live forever and I'm going to die. So, you know, so can we just take it as part of life, you know. So the people around me got okay. Because, you know, they are the ones who are so scared and so worried about you that you feel guilty, you know, making them feel so upset. So I think it's very important to keep them, or make them, patients, families realize that you are normal and, you know, something that's going to come and go.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. One second. I think she had already put up her hand. You'll have to make a question small because we have only time for two more.
I just want to share a very small experience.
Right, okay.
They say Devana Manishar Rupaya, Dr. Kartikeyan came as Deva to help me. He introduced me to Ketan Shah. You all know about him. He's the acupressure man. I had terrible back pain. I was taken to Max Hospital. They took an MRI and said, there's a little kink, you take painkillers if it works. If otherwise, we'll have to put you on surgery. I don't want to go for the surgery. And he came and said, come to Ketan Shah, he will cure you. I went there and he showed me acupressure, not acupuncture. I was scared of acupuncture.
Workshop, a retreat on forgiveness, because I saw. See, with Vipassana, you get aware. You begin to accept, and then you begin to get aware. And when you become aware, then it's not that I am angry. It's no longer I am sad. It is, this is an angry thought, and this is a sad thought. You really actually begin to learn to be the observer. And that is what I saw. And that gave me the ability. Well, love is unconditional. At that point of time, well, no matter how much work I had done, I still had a journey. See, this is a journey. I really don't know what is in store, but I am in divine surrender, willing to accept every moment. And the power, you know, the moment of power is now. And that's where I am right now. We take it as it comes. And I'm also clear that the last door is not shut. So the journey is not scary. There's no fear. There's no stress. And love is loving yourself, firstly. I was not loving myself. It begins with loving yourself and respecting yourself, because only if I love and respect myself will I be able to love and respect another. So I was hating myself. I was resenting a lot of stuff about myself. So what I was giving out was indirectly resentment and hate as well. So the key is to begin to learn to love and respect ourselves. And there are ways to begin to love and respect ourselves without hurting ourselves. That's what I learned, and that's what I do all the time. And before I close, I would really like to say one thing, that I was at a Life Positive Expo about 6 years back, more than that, when I actually came to know through somebody that Louise Hay was running her workshops. I had a book, but I didn't know that there were workshops based on the book. So I want to express my gratitude to each and every one of you with Life Positive, because it is through you that I actually met Louise and I could do this work, and today I'm a teacher of love and I'm able to give it away to each and every person. And lastly, gratitude is very important. With every breath I express gratitude, and as I express gratitude, my life becomes a miracle.
Wonderful, Babu. Thank you so much. And please write about it for Life Positive. We'll be happy to carry it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now this, just a minute. Yeah,
please.
This gentleman has something to
say. Yes, please.
Among all the discussions we've been having from morning and
night, yeah,
having so-called experts give it to us.
Yeah.
Just a minute, everyone. Everyone, let's.
From morning, we've been listening to all the experts.
Yeah.
Men, Muslim. It's wonderful to see that the panel, or so-called panel, of giving stories are the women.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
They are more conducive to change and belief.
Yes.
And to enable to understand the grace of God.
Yeah.
That's a very sweet thing to say, but we had a male person, unfortunately, who didn't show up.
Yeah.
Because I personally believe in my spiritual journey,
yeah,
as I said, the feminine energy is going to come back, and that's what's going to heal the world. So thank you all for sharing your love.
Thank you so much. You wanted to say something.
Thank you.
I'm supposed to give the concluding remarks.
Yes.
So that we still have to get to it. Now we'll walk out of this stage.
No, you'll still be there.
Achha, you are going to do that, is it? How does it work out? We're closing and we're moving out, and then, right? Yeah. All right, so thank you so much, Jamuna, Babu, and Benita. You're incredibly inspiring stories, I'm sure, we'll carry away with us when we leave this hall. Thank you all, audience, for being so receptive.
Thank you so much.
And we now invite Rajesh to take over.